What I want to do in the next few minutes, can you hear me? Is this even on? Yeah? Yeah, good. This might be a little bit clunky because we're going to try to use something new. Look at this cool thing, right? Aren't you excited? I'm so excited about this. You have no idea. Been wanting to do this for a long, long time. So what I need you to do is, what we're going to do over the next few minutes is I want to give you a theology of marriage. I know it's like class for me. Don't worry. You'll like it. I promise. It's a biblical argument for how marriage began, how it was ruined in the fall, and then how it's redeemed in Christ. You can take, it's what we call a biblical theology, because the arc of the Bible is basically that, okay? You have the creation account, right? Naked and unashamed, praise the Lord. And then you have the fall and the ripple effects of sin that go through everything. And then you have redemption in Christ. And the idea is that you're sat in those mirrors, you know, like you're looking in the mirror and you could open it up like this so you can see the different sides of your face. But if you stand back, it's just reflecting each other. That's the idea when you have creation and you have redemption. They're supposed to, Christ redeems us and brings us back to the ideal, right? And there are some arguments. In fact, we are going to be even better off in eternity than we were in the created order, because we will know things about the character of God like grace, right? Because you wouldn't know that if we hadn't gone through the fall and redemption, yes? Mercy, justice, all of these things that we know about God, we would only know if we went through this process, okay? And so what I want to do is, you can do this with almost every subject in the Bible. When you say, what does the Bible say about... I'm usually going to approach it and saying, all right, so what was the original intent? How did the fall affect it? And then how is it restored in Christ? And then how do we read ultimately about the full redemption in eternity? Got it? Creation, fall, redemption, restoration. You think, like, this is the scene. You're like, God, come on, this is ridiculous. Are you really doing this? Well, God knows that Adam, none of these complete him. But he's trying, it's meant to prove something to Adam, that there's nothing on the created world that corresponds to you like what I'm going to give you. Like, she's uniquely made to correspond just for you. And that's what happens. There wasn't found a helper fit for him. The Lord caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. And the first thing he does is he sings a love song. That's why it's offset, right? It's a poem. This at last is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called, now in Hebrew, Isha, because she was taken out of Ish. You see the similarity? Isha, she's just the feminine form of me. She's exactly like me. Just a woman, right? And so he sings this love song because he's thrilled. And he's, you know, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh means, of course, she fits me. She was taken out of me, she fits me. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Is there a command there? Can I just hit pause on everything? I'm just going to try to correct something that everybody talks about in marriage. Is that a command? You know the difference? Is it a description of what will be, or is it a description of what should be? Anyone? You think so? A should would be, let it be, right? We would expect it to say, therefore, let a man leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife. That's a command, right? This is not a command. This is a statement of fact, which, by the way, so it ruins most of the wedding sermons that anybody ever gives. Because they say, you need to leave and cleave. And I'm like, no, the Bible says you will. But this whole idea of leaving and cleaving your family and, you know, going and being your own independent thing, guys, I'm just going to tell you, this is a nuclear family made-up thing. The whole world doesn't live like that. That doesn't mean that you're not supposed to be your own, you know, that you will eventually be your own unit. You will, of course you will. But that doesn't mean you can't live with your parents. It doesn't mean that you can't still, I mean, in those days, well, the first thing that would happen when you get married is you'd live with on the compound with a guy's family. That's why they paid a bride price, because she gets to come and live with us now. So I know it's if you did that, you'd be like, oh, that's so weird. But I'm like, no, because they're going to tell you to leave and cleave. Sometimes that's the worst thing you can be told to do, because you have no idea what you're doing. So sometimes the best thing for you to do in your first little while of marriage is to actually have a little bit of help around. You know, in mothers-in-laws, that can be a pain. But sometimes it's nice to have some people around who are going to help you with some of the details of the first thing. You shouldn't feel bad about that. You also don't need to. But that's not a command. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh, which has sexual overtones. Absolutely. And the man and his wife were both naked and not ashamed. This is that's an amazing statement. Naked and unashamed. Like if I'm ever naked anywhere, I'm ashamed. Okay? It doesn't matter where I am. If nobody's around, I'm like, if I could be on that show, you know, Naked or whatever it's called, alone, and I'd be naked and I'd be like, this is ridiculous. You know, this is disgusting. Doesn't matter. God can see me. I'm like, ooh. Right? But the idea is that you are the most vulnerable if you're naked, right? Like you, there it is, every part of it, do you know? But they didn't even know it. They were naked and they didn't know it. Completely unashamed, which means a very open relationship between the two of them, right? So in the created order, the created design, what you have is basically a complementarity between these two. We would say that there is an order to creation. The Apostle Paul in 1 Timothy 2 really goes after this, and he says, look, God could have created these two at the same time, but he wanted the husband to show leadership and headship over his wife. That's not like a harsh authority language. That's no, he's going to answer for things. As you will see, he does in the fall. I mean, when God shows up, who's he going to call for? Adam. But they're supposed to be, the man is loving his wife, they are open in their relationship, and they are for each other, naked and unashamed. There's no shame, nothing to hide between the two of them. Their relationship with God is open, their relationship with each other is open, their relationship with their world is open and honest and fruitful. It's blissful. Then, I mean, you know the story, the serpent shows up and he ends up telling her, hey, she takes the bite of the apple. Okay? Verse 8, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. So we went to creation, and now here's the fall. Walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of God, the Lord God, among the trees of the garden. Do you think that's a smart thing to do? Well, how about I say this? Do you think that's possible to do? No, of course it's not. Which is why it's also interesting how you and I, we run away from God, and we think somehow that if we're doing these particular activities over here, the Lord doesn't really know, you know? We can dupe him by doing these things and still pretending that we're a really good person. Actually, you're as stupid as they were, if that's the case, right? You're like, oh, I'm going to put these behind the tree over here, and you're not going to see it, God. No, he sees it. Man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to who? He called to the man, and he said to him, where are you? Now, he doesn't need to know the answer to that. He already knows. There's a double meaning in that. It's meant to make Adam reflect. What's gone on here, Adam? Where are you, Adam? And he said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked. Whoa, 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 whoa. So, who told you you were naked? How did you become aware of yourself? How did the focus go away from her and from me and from the world to now you and worrying about me and how all this works, right? You're naked. Yeah, and then here comes the what happens every time sin happens. Who told you were naked? Have you eaten the tree which I commanded you not to eat? The woman who you gave to be with me. Don't you love that line? With her, and you gave her. Do you know? Do you remember that whole animal thing? And you brought her. Dude, it's not my fault, right? You set this up. The woman who you gave to be with me, she gave fruit of the tree and I ate it. And then the Lord God goes down the line and he says to the woman, what is this you've done? And she said, look, it's not me, snake. And the Lord God, he doesn't ask the snake, do you have anything to say for yourself? He immediately just goes right into the curse. Now listen to the curses. Because you've done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go. Listen, I don't know if the snake had legs before this, apparently, according to this. But the idea is that his travel is frustrated now. It's not like he didn't travel before. It's just he can't do it as well. Dust you shall eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity. Now there's frustration. There wasn't frustration between the woman, the man, and the created world. But now there is. I'll put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel, which is a lovely statement that we could talk about for a long time about what they call the proto-euangelion. It's the first preaching of the gospel, but leave it there. To the woman, he said, all right, so now he goes to the serpent. He's going to come back up the line of authority. Woman, he said, and this is my big point. I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing. You guys realize that there probably was no pain in childbearing in the created design? So thanks, Eve. In pain, you shall bring forth children. The point I'm making here is it's a frustration of something they were already doing. And your desire shall be contrary to your husband's. But he shall rule over you. The language here is used in the next chapter to talk about sin, crouching at the door of Cain. And God says, listen, its desire is for you, but you must rule over it. In other words, it wants to dominate you, Cain, and you must dominate it. So you take that language here and you realize your desire shall be contrary to him. You want to rule over him. You want to dominate him, and he wants to dominate you. Welcome to the world. If you ask me what the problem is in most marriages, it's that. It's that. Everybody wants to be right. Everybody wants to be the one who gets the authority. Everybody wants, and we fight for it, and we fight for it, and we fight for it. And what often happens is that men either pull back, because they're like, well, I don't want to fight about it. And then they let their wife move forward as the leader of the home and all those sorts of things, which many times she might be capable of, but it's not what God's called her to do. And so he pulls back, and then he becomes this little mealy mouse just sitting on the TV, sitting on the couch watching the TV and playing video games all day. Or he goes the other way, and he says, you know what? I'm the leader in this house. And he squishes them down. And That's the way most marriages I've experienced have gone. I sit in rooms and I counsel people. But you see, the point is, in the created design, you have this open, honest relationship with each other. You have naked and unashamed. And then you have shame brought between the couple. You have accusation between the couple, right? She did it. No, the serpent did it. And then you have this frustration. God, I hid from you because I thought I was naked. So everything has been like frustrated all around the edges. And that's the way the rest of the Bible goes. You'll see all sorts of horrible examples of marriages gone sour. I mean, Abram's gonna show up and he's gonna put out his wife for the highest bidder. This is my wife. He doesn't tell him that. Do you like my sister? She's lovely, she's yours. Like, what are you doing, man? This is disgusting, right? But this is the way that the relationships work. Anyway, what you have then is you get to the New Testament, and this is the redemption of the story. So in Christ, these things are redeemed. You guys are following this, right? So it's quick, but so here's where we're going to go. I'm going to go to Ephesians chapter 5. Look at this. Let's go here. Ephesians. Come on, you stupid bugger. There it is. What I want you to see, okay? In Ephesians 5, what you're going to find is the renewal of the married relationship, all right? So this is the last part I want to show you. Look carefully how you walk, verse 15, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that's debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. That's a command, okay? Be filled with the Spirit. Now, he's going to see these words addressing, one another in psalms, and singing and making melody in the heart with the Lord, and giving thanks and submitting to one another. By the way, I should just do this, but I don't want to waste the time, but I'm so excited about it, I'm going to show you. Watch what I can do. You excited yet? No, hold on. Don't worry. Look, I can draw on the screen right here. Watch. Ready? Addressing, singing, giving thanks, and submitting. So the main verb here, okay, be filled, there it is, with the Spirit. That's the command. Be filled. What does it look like when you're filled with the Spirit, according to Paul? Well, it looks like addressing one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. You know, somebody's filled with the Spirit when they've got a song in their heart. And they're always giving thanks. You know somebody's not filled with the Spirit when they're whining all the time. Giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you know people are filled with the Spirit when they're submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, this word, submitting, the relationships in which you submit are now described down here. Everyone is involved in a submission and authority relationship. All of us are. It was part of God's original design when he made Adam first and then Eve, and we have a relationship with God where he's the leader and we're the submitters. There's nothing wrong with submitting to righteous, good authority. Amen? I know that we're Americans and we're like, no, there's not. But the reason that we don't want to submit to authorities is because all the authorities in the world usually end up becoming wicked. But there's nothing wrong with authority and submission. So we're all in these authority submission relationships, and we will be for all eternity. There will be bosses, and there'll be workers, and there will be princes, and there will be all sorts of different relationships. And that doesn't mean that I'm less than anyone. If I'm doing this job and I'm working third tier on the supply chain, that doesn't mean that I'm less. I'm the same as the value of the guy on the top. It's just that my job is different, okay? So here are the submission relationships particular that he's interested in. Wives, there's not even this verb submit to, it's not even in the passage, it's borrowing from this word. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ in grief, it says, wives to your husbands as to the Lord. So a wife is supposed to submit to her husband as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church's body and is itself his Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Okay, so here's the way it's redeemed. Marriage now is supposed to be a picture to the whole world of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That when people look at a marriage, they're supposed to say, wow, look at the way that he loves her in this sacrificial way. You know, remember how Jesus loves his people? He gets down on his hands and knees and he washes the feet. He doesn't lord it over them like the Gentiles do. It's sacrificial enough that he goes to the cross. He takes the hit. That's the kind of love that he's supposed to show for her. At every single point, he's supposed to be the one who is in the firing line. He's supposed to be the one who goes out and takes the punishment. Guys, I mean, I felt really bad the other night. My wife got up out of our bed because there was a sound downstairs, and she started walking downstairs like she was going to take care of it, and I was laying there and going, good. You know, like, I'm so tired. I don't want to do this. And then I felt really guilty because I was like, oh, Jeff, you're such a loser. So then I got my bat, which, don't you come to my house, dude. You're going to get hit. I got my bat, and I walked down, like, kind of behind her, and she was downstairs. She had it all sorted. I was like, I'm right here, honey. You know, I'm going to take care of all this. But the idea is that you're supposed to be the guy who's, you know, Gandalf, you shall not pass, that guy. You shall be that guy. Into relationships and everything. How does Jesus love us? He shows care for us. He consoles us. He leads us at a time and a pace that's appropriate for us. He seeks us to flourish in our gifts, right? He's constantly giving of himself. If there's somebody who's got to take a sacrifice in the family so others can be helped, it's Jesus to the church. So it's the man to the wife. And the response then that a wife has to that is, I have a heart, a willingness, and a disposition to yield. I want to be the complement in the family. I want to do my part. And sometimes, listen, sometimes that might be a different in every different kind of family, because just like a coach or the captain of the team has authority over the rest of the team, sometimes the captain asks the next player, the best player on the team, to take the last shot. That doesn't mean the person taking the last shot is in authority. The captain is in authority. They just say, this person is really good at these things, so they're going to do this. So in the division of labor in a home, it really is up to the team itself, but especially the captain, to put everyone in a position where they're able to flourish. Do you understand? Do you follow that? So it's not this harsh, heavy-handed, you do what I say. No, absolutely not. It's, what are you good at? How can we actually take advantage of your skills and abilities? Because I might be really bad at administration and money, but you might be amazing at it. We're gonna put you in charge of that. And I'm going to delegate all of this to you. And as an act of love and sacrifice on my part, I'm actually even going to submit to your decisions regarding the money. That's good leadership, guys. So do you see how it works? You have this beautiful complementarity, and then it's ruined with people fighting, and then you have this, like, we're trying to outdo each other in service to one another, right? I went longer than I was supposed to, didn't I? I don't care. Like, it doesn't matter to me. Okay, we're done. Okay, we're done with that. Now we're going to talk here, applications. You're like, oh, what does that mean? Okay, so then we're going to have this trial. What is it called?
Yeah, we'll go with trial.
Same thing.
Trial by fire. Thank you, Jeff. That's great.
Yep.
Praise the Lord for the Bible. So we have a lovely group of people that are going to come up and join us. Basically, the goal is to process a little bit of like application with where we're at with all this. If this is the goal, marriage, the way that God's word says and Jeff taught, then how do I get there, or how do I process just where I am, and how should I live? So Jeff is going to come back up, and he's actually brought his wife, Jeannie, who we love as well. She's going to come up. I'm going to sit here and moderate, and my wife, Stephanie, is going to come up. And we have two of our lovely single young adults who we value their opinion and we love greatly. Brian and Lisette are going to come up and join us as well. And so I think, we need another microphone, I think. Lewis, which microphone should I take? Any of them? Where are they? Oh, right here. Here we go.
This one's still on.
Here, here's one that you guys can pass around. Oh, there we go. Okay. Here's another one. Just flip that bad boy on.
I have this thing on my head.
Oh. Yeah, that's beautiful. So might have to turn that one off every so often. The one that's hooked up to his face. So we have some questions prepared that we think might be helpful. But we know that we're not inside of your heads, and we don't know what might be helpful to you. And so if you have a question for the single people, feel free to submit a question that you have for them. If you have a question for the married people, feel free to submit a question. Like, whatever. Just submit any questions. Also, that's my phone number. So, like, I don't care that you have it. I just, for, like, discretion, like, you need to know if I have your contact.
Well, what if I have a question, like, 2 a.m. or whatever.
Like, whatever. See, Anna already said, am I excited to go to Disney? Like, yes, of course. I love Disney World, if you didn't know. Right, Jeff?
I think Disney adults are a unique kind of thing.
Thank you. Yeah. Just know that if I have your phone number, you plan on me knowing who it's your phone number, I'll know who asked it. So, like, it's anonymous, but not totally anonymous. But it shouldn't matter. So we're just gonna get cracking. So we've preached at various times once here. Jeff's preached from the main stage. 1 Corinthians 7, right? We talk about marriage being a beautiful thing here. And it is a gift from God, and there's a redemption in it. But we also know that the Bible would teach us that singleness is a great gift. It is not to be diminished.
It's a gift to be cherished, not a burden to carry.
Exactly, exactly. And so, for many of us who either desire to be married and aren't, or don't know what they think about that yet, how can I value marriage and singleness simultaneously? How can I value both of the gifts that the Lord gives? And is it wrong for me to dislike singleness? So anyone who has an idea on this,
I'll jump in because yes.
Yep.
The assumption in the Bible is that most people will be married. I know that sounds maybe odd, but the creation account that I just gave is the way it is because it the assumption is most people will eventually be married. That's actually true, right? We serve a single Savior. Right? Jesus wasn't married, so that doesn't mean that you're imperfect if you're not married. But the assumption is you're probably going to be married at some point, and it's a good thing for you to desire. Absolutely a good thing. The thing about singleness is everyone needs to understand that everyone is gifted for it with it at some point in their life. Right? So it's not like someone who's single is some weird anomaly. No, they've just been gifted for it at a different period, or they might be gifted for it for longer. They might be, but that's everyone is. So if you're not married right now, guess what? You have the gift of singleness. And so you should cherish it the best way you can. You do know that part of the way you cherish that is by committing yourself further to the work of the Lord, wherever it is that he places you. Because it does give you some freedom, some time, that you don't have to commit to a relationship. So you're able to do more things, which is really remarkable. The kinds of things that single women missionaries especially have done in the world have been unbelievable because they recognize that, look, I'm single for this time, and then many of them got married, right, later, and they lived a different kind of life, but still missionaries. But you can love two things at the same time and affirm both things at the same time.
Hello? Okay, I think there's a way to not like the season you're in, but do it with joy. There's a way of doing it where you are like, I am focused on my season versus focused on the Savior. Because a lot of times that's the issue that we kind of run into when it comes to singleness or even with marriage. I run into people who are like, I hate that I'm married. And then they're, with those conversations, being able to say, the Lord, your God, is your husband. The Lord your God cares for you, and knowing that making a status the object of your affection will always leave you disappointed.
And it's great, though, for you to want to be married.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
Next one.
I'm not having that.
Yeah, no.
So then, what should someone do who is discontent with their singleness, and can they one day learn to be content with it? And how can I learn to be content with it?
Prayerfully, I would say if you're someone who's struggling with being single, you should be surrendering that to the Lord through prayer. Not necessarily something that might happen immediately, but like David did in the Psalms, you should be talking that out with the Lord. Why, God? Or, hey, God, maybe you're showing me some of the great things about this season.
Philippians 4, you guys, anytime anybody asks the question about contentment or anything, there's actually a passage of Scripture that talks directly about it. So Paul says, he gets this gift of money from the Philippian church, and he says to them, it's not that I needed the money, though. I want you to know that I'm thankful for the money that you've given, but as a missionary, I don't need the money I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have lots. I've learned this, the language, I've learned the secret of being content in any and every circumstance. And, okay, he's relating that to money, but that applies to any situation where you want something more than what you have. So what's the secret? You know it. Steph Curry wrote it on his shoes, right? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. In other words, that Jesus can take care of me. That might sound trite, but it's been something in my life about money that has been revolutionary. I grew up in my dad made quite a bit of money. I grew up in a family that did very well. I liked lots of nice things, and then we got married, and we moved to New Zealand and had nothing, like dirt nothing, like made so little money. And it drove me crazy. I was very frustrated with the Lord over and over again, and then it eventually occurred to me that there's all these promises in the scripture that Jesus will take care of me regardless of how much or how little I have, so money just becomes this tool and an opportunity to bless people with. And for some reason, it totally shifted my thinking. It's to the point, to be honest with you, like, we get hit with bills and stuff these days, and we're kind of like, well, that sucks. Oh, well. Do you know, like, well, Lord will figure out a way to provide for us, because it's not, you know, we know what it's like to not have much and to live. We don't live lives that are really that different now than what we did then. So I'd say the same thing about singleness, is that okay, you don't have a spouse. You'll know what it's like to have and not to have at some point, but either way, Jesus is the one who's going to be the one who, you can do all things through him who strengthens you. And I know that sounds trite and Christian, but what it's basically saying is, look, you can trust the Lord to provide for you what you need.
I was just going to add to that too. I know I think it comes down to contentment too. And for me, over my life, just trying to find contentment in the Lord. And one of the verses that the Lord has continually reminded me of is in 1 Peter 5, 6 and 7, 6, 7, 8, it's in there. and it starts out with, submit yourself under the mighty hand of God. So it starts with submitting to and a recognition that God is sovereign. And I think part of contentment is just submission to what it is that he has for me right now. And my whole life there's been things, whether it's finances, whether it's marriage or singleness, whether it's, there's all kinds of life circumstances. But if there's a submission to the sovereignty of God, the goodness of God, and then the next verse in 7, it says to cast all your cares on him or give all your worries to him because he cares for you. Cast your cares on him, for he cares for you. That's the old version that I learned when I was a kid. And that is, I think that comes second after you submit to the knowledge that he's sovereign and cast your cares on him. I think just pray, like, again, prayerfully. Tell him the things you want. But also, there's a tension in that resting in where he has you. That's all.
I want to echo what Brian said about prayerfully. When I was really wrestling with singleness, I had a couple people who I had pray with me. Of, hey, I'm really wrestling with this. Can you pray with me? Can you hold me accountable to this? And pray. And also, I said, pray if this is not a desire from the Lord, if this is something that, like, I need to, like, be more content in my singleness, pray for that. And if it's for a spouse, pray for that. So I prayed, had people pray for both those things for me. And also was praying both those things of, like, Lord, your will be done in my life. And so I think really this is a good opportunity to have community around you when it comes to when you're feeling discontent, you need to talk to people. This is a good opportunity to be able to share with others and have them carry that burden with you.
I just want to share, like, my own experience. So I come from a Hispanic household. I don't know what other cultures are like, but, like, for me, like, it's since we're little, we're engraved, like, you are meant to get married. So I'm 31 now, so my parents are like low-key having heart attacks because they're like, you're not married and you're single. And then my mom's like, Lissa, do you plan on getting married? I was like, I don't know, Mom, whatever God wants for me. One thing that I learned was, like, your purpose in life is not to get married. Your purpose in life to glorify God. So married or single, they're both glorifying God. And also, like, the enemy always makes you focus on the one thing you don't have. So, like, just personally for me, it's, like, count your blessings. Like, I'm going on a mission trip from June to September, and I'm going to be at a camp where there's really no Wi-Fi. So for me, it's like I can't really date because I'm not going to be available for 3 months. It's different. Like with my friends and family, that's different. I'm like, okay, guys, I'll see you back in September. But if I'm in a relationship and we're trying to grow and see what God has for us in the future, that's not realistically, that's not possible. So I think just like taking that time just to get closer to God, to be have your identity in Christ rather than the person you're trying to pursue or trying to be with. Because you are who you are in Christ, not what your husband says you are, or future husband, or boyfriend, whatever. So, yeah.
That's good. So, I've got a question that has to do with maybe if you're somebody who's dating, or even if you're somebody who's not dating. So, when will you know that you're someone who's ready for marriage? If you're in a dating relationship, how do you know you're ready? If you're not, how do you know you're ready? And maybe I'll add this. How do you know if you're not ready?
From a counseling perspective, I'm just going to say this real quick. You can get married at any time. Is it the best time to get married? And I think that's one of the things that a lot of us are like, oh, like, I just have to get married. I just have to. I don't want to miss my time. And the fact is, yes, if you really wanted to right now, you could just, oh, there's a guy off the street or a girl off the street. Hey, you want to get married? You could do that. But is that the best decision for you? And I think it is, like, I mean, seriously. And I think as you're, I mean, we talked about this already, prayerfully. Because it's one thing to say, to have a desire. It's another thing, which God knows our desires. It's another thing to try to take our desire into our own hands and try to grasp at something when the fruit is not. I love in Song of Solomon, it says, don't awaken love till it's season. And we want to be able to recognize what season we're in. So, but people can add more to that, but there's something.
I listen, I think most of the things that people say about being ready for marriage and the reason that what I hear from people when I've been involved in counseling, it's been like financial. It's always been, I guess, attitude. There's a whole bunch of things, and I always want to say those are all dumb reasons. Why shouldn't you get married if you are so selfish that you don't have the ability to love somebody else and sacrifice for them? I will tell you this though, marriage is a sanctifying work, and it will teach you how to do that. I promise you, it will teach you how to do that, right? Living in the same close quarters with another sinner does that. I often want to tell people, like, you're not going to be good at it at the beginning. It's okay. Nobody is. Nobody's good at it at the very get-go. You know, that's why sometimes first years of marriage is really hard. Other times they're not. Because the people who get married are, you know, they have a real heart to sacrifice for one another and their commonality and their thinking. But I think most people are more ready than they think. How's that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that if you're jumping from one relationship to another, I honestly don't think you're ready for marriage because you can't even be content by yourself. And I think most people find, again, their worth in that person rather than in God. And I think that one thing that I've learned from talking to different, especially girls, it's like, I just want a boyfriend that can take me to the pumpkin patch and we can wear matching flannels and all these things. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, what's wrong with you? I'm sorry. That's my honest opinion. I think you don't want someone's going to take you on a nice date. You want someone that's going to go to war with you. So someone that's going to lead you closer to Christ, because the whole purpose of marriage is for, again, sanctification, is to burst into direct you towards God and bring you closer to God, not someone that's going to take you further away from God. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
I think another thing I'd say, if you are not self-aware, that's going to be really hard entering into marriage, of being aware of your sin, being aware of strongholds you have. I think as much as you can be aware of what's my stuff before you go in, because it's just going to get amplified in marriage. And, like, I'm so thankful we had great premarital counseling and all those things, but again, we sit and do pastoral counseling and things like that. Just having a real look at yourself and saying, am I selfish? Do I have a stronghold of sin that I cannot let go of? I might need to really work on that before I'm trying to invite someone else into this, especially if you're a guy trying to lead a woman. If I'm trying to lead a household, I need to die to that.
Sorry. I was just saying that we didn't have premarital counseling. We had one meeting, and then we didn't go anymore. But it wasn't on purpose.
You're here.
And then she said to me, it might have helped us. And so, which was surprising to me to hear.
I think another thing, if you are ready, I'm sorry I'm talking a lot, is your community will affirm it if you are ready. Like, if you're not ready, there's going to be people in your life that go, hey, I think you might need to pause. This is why you do all this stuff in community. Like, everything, I'm going to probably say that 12,000 times, is community, community, community. But you'll have people speaking to you, this is a good thing, I think this relationship's really good. Or, hey, I think you need to pause on this. I don't think this is the right thing for you. But that's with trusted people. Anyways. I'm done talking.
So how can I make sure and assess that I'm somebody who is looking forward to the marriage with my spouse, a person, and I'm not just looking forward to being married? How can I assess that in my life, of what my desire actually is? Do I want a marriage, or do I want to be married?
Is that a concern? Sorry, I'm asking that, but is that a... I've never actually heard that. That somebody would actually just want to be married and not married to the person? They just want, like, a fill-in? Like somebody to be
Yeah,
there.
That's definitely a thing.
Okay. Don't do that.
If it is as simple as that, I think that's...
You know, one of the things though, that people do a lot, though, is if this is what you're getting at, it is very common for people to overlook yellow flags when they're dating. You are marrying the person who you have, not the one who you hope you'll have. Mm-hmm. So, but with that said, again, we have a dear friend she's single today, Karen, and she's great. She's like a sister to us. And but you know, you get in conversations with her sometimes, and she'd be like, you know, problem is I never meet a guy who's like, and then she'll list off all these guys who she knows who are married because she knows. You know, this couple over here and our friend Nate, who's a really great husband. The problem is, I've told her before, but you're evaluating Nate now after the chastisement of marriage, right? Nate was an idiot before he got married, right? So was I. So on the one hand, don't ignore the yellow flags. Be realistic about the person that you're marrying. You don't want to, believe me, the life that you're going to have if you marry somebody who is... and I'll say it, somebody who doesn't share your heart's cry when it comes to Christ, whose commitment to Jesus is not something that is similar to yours. Jeannie's dad used to say, you should marry a learning, growing Christian. Not just a Christian, a learning, growing Christian. But if that's not the case, don't think, oh, one day they're going to be amazing. Maybe. Maybe. One day they also might take your kids away from Christ, because that happens a lot. And I say that especially to young women. You do need to know the statistics and how important a father is to the spiritual life of their children. It's actually ridiculous how important it is. So if you want to have kids who follow Jesus, which I think is probably one of the biggest things you want in your whole life, if you get married and have kids, I'm telling you, it's like the number one thing. You will probably set the stage for that by being realistic about the person that you're marrying and saying, I'm going to marry somebody who loves the Lord and has a commitment to love the Lord.
Question for some of the married people in the house and those to look forward to, like, how do I do this? How do you let your husband lead? And Stephanie, don't answer this one.
You want to go?
Classic.
You go. You start.
Oh boy.
I think the biggest thing is, again, this is like going back to prayer. Like, I'm praying for my husband all the time and praying for him. How is, like, trusting his leadership, praying for him, praying for the decisions he's making for our home. Two, I talk to him about things that I'm concerned about, that I'm worried about. Like, hey, like, I'm wondering about this. And also dying to my pride. Like, I think that's the biggest thing. Like, I was single for, I don't know, like, quite a while. And like, I'm from a Southern household, which is like, you're supposed to get married at 18, and I did not. And all my friends were like, you're an old maid. And I was like, great. thanks, guys. But with that, I had so many, like, I had my single life. Like, I knew, I was like, this is my routine, this is my, and I had to say, like, I need to trust that my husband wants the best for me. And I don't have to always think I know best. And I can say, hey, I think this would be the best thing to do, but I want to submit when he's like, no, I really think this is the best thing to do. So, yeah.
He's a good leader if he listens. And listen, one of the keys to leadership in anything is you have to start where people are, not where you think they ought to be, which is very frustrating anytime you lead anything, because you're going to demand and want people to be where you think they ought to be. But leadership is trying to figure out how you can get them there, period. And sticks are terrible. Carrots are great to get there, because they're willing then, and they want to be a part of it and that kind of thing. And so most of the time, you know, I think most men can help their wives in this regard by showing them deference and love by saying, so what should we do? What do you think we should do? How should we go about this? What do you think? Instead of just, you know, being a tool and just saying, we're going over here. And, yeah.
Yeah, I think the definition of submission being the willingness, being kind of the idea of that it's the willingness to yield, has always been a helpful just way of thinking about it for me. Because I think there's a lot of baggage around the word submission in our culture, and immediately, I think in a lot of people it gets their back up. Like, I don't like that word, but the idea of being willing to yield to someone else. I mean, we do that all the time in our friendships and in our work relationships and in our. So why wouldn't we do that with someone that we love, and we've committed to live our lives with? But I think it takes a daily yielding to Christ, and that it's not something that always comes natural. I mean, naturally we're stubborn and prideful, and I think we have to just keep yielding.
It's what Jesus did with his father, though, right?
To him first,
right? Garden of Gethsemane, that your will be done. Like, there's a kind of surrender that has to happen in certain areas. I'm not sure I want this to happen. We're going to go down this way because I think that this is what you know, the Lord has for us, that kind of thing. You're not obligated to yield to any anyone, everybody, number one. You're obligated to yield to those who are in authority over you, according to God, right? So government. And you're not obligated to yield to governments or any other authority when they don't want to do what Jesus says is right, period. You can say, I really want to yield to you, but this is not right. This isn't right. Our motives are wrong, or whatever are wrong. Do you know that at the end of that passage that was in Ephesians 5, Paul sums up what he wants wives to do with their husband. He says, but wives, also respect your husbands. I actually think that's probably the best line, because that's all men want, period. They just want to be respected, and by respected, they want to be seen as I looked up to. They want to be somebody who's like, you know, I'm proud of you. I think highly of you, and I couldn't be more happy about these areas of your life and who you are. I think that is one of the ways that you can support a husband, is by pumping his tires a bit. Most guys, by the way, are weak-kneed, and believe it or not, they really do question what in the world they're doing. They do. And what they need is some people behind it and saying, I'm with you. No matter where we go, I'm coming. And, you know.
And I was going to say that then part of that is believing the best in each other, right? Like, it's so easy to not get into the critical, nagging, I know better attitude, but believing the best, that whatever the decision was, that I believe the best in you. I believe that you had a good intention, even if it might have looked different than I would have done it. I believe the best in you.
It's always different than the way you would have done it. It's hard for her. I'm like a total outside the box guy. Jeannie's like, can we just keep our heads down and get through this? And I'm like, yeah, but look around that corner. We can go that way and get in over there. And she's like, ah. Oh.
I have a bit of an exegetical question. We talked about 1 Corinthians 7, and it is very important to this issue. So if you don't know what we're talking about when we're saying this gift of singleness in 1 Corinthians 7, I highly encourage you to go and read it. But the question is, where Paul is giving his opinions about remaining unmarried, which seems to differ from God's design for marriage, what is he doing? And I'll just read this. 1 Corinthians 7:25, now concerning the betrothed or engaged in that time. I have no command from the Lord, but I give my judgment as one who by the Lord's mercy is trustworthy. I think that in the view of the present dark distress, it is good for a person to remain as he is. Are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be free. Are you free from a wife or not yet married? Do not seek a wife. Which he then says, if you do marry, you haven't sinned. And if a betrothed woman marries, she has not sinned. Yet those who marry will have worldly troubles. So what's going on there? Jeff, really?
He's arguing. He's essential. First of all, you know that line at the beginning says, I don't have this from the Lord, but this is my opinion. This doesn't mean that, hey, this is really less authoritative. What he means is there's not a direct command of Jesus in the Gospels to this particular issue, so let me as an apostle now speak to it. I think given the present distress, and by that he means, look guys, the coming of Christ is soon. We live in a world on fire. There are so many needs and so many things going on that we have enough to focus on. If we have enough to focus on apart from focusing our whole lives on, you know, living out the great romantic comedy. So, don't worry too much about your situation, okay? It's not wrong to change it if that is an opportunity that comes up, but this is basically what we said before, that flourish where you are, do the best you can where you are, serve the Lord where you are, and the Lord will bring about those things for you in his good timing. But the days are short. That's the point. The days are short. Christ is coming. There are people who need to know Jesus. There are, you know, immigrants coming into our communities who have nothing. There are people all over the place who are, you know, stuck in gang violence. And there's so many different ways for us to serve and help, not just the local churches, but out in the community and these sorts of things. That those are the things that we can focus on and take advantage of our present situation to do. Also, it's written to people who were thinking in Corinth. They were like, you know what? We're basically like the angels. We should just get divorced. You know what I mean? They're not going to be married in heaven. And so he's like, whoa, 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 whoa. No, stop it. Stop it. Just wherever it is you are, live faithfully in that situation.
Yeah, that's good. Now, so I have a interesting question. So, like, there is, for those who are single, a lot of waiting and patience and frustration, speaking from personal experience, while you're desiring your spouse and they're not there yet and you don't know why. And so, in the meantime, right, the man of God, the woman of God is not here yet. Is it okay for me to flirt while I am waiting? That's the question. Hey, don't laugh at what you were thinking, all right? Like, is it okay to flirt while I'm waiting for this person? What do you think? I don't know. Is there a biblical answer to this?
Oh, you're looking at me? I'm like, yeah. What are you talking about?
How do you get married?
What are you saying? What, are you supposed to sit in a room with a beautiful and woman, whatever, and be like, I am totally not, I'm stoic now. I'm not paying attention to you at all because I'm serving Jesus. Like, come on, get over it, dude. Get in there. What are you doing? Like, what are you talking about?
Are you saying it's wrong to be stoic?
Sometimes, yeah. Right?
I feel attacked.
When the Lord throws a middle fastball to you, swing, brother. Like, what are you doing?
Or the woman's perspective? What does that look like? Anyone?
Look. It's not wrong to be friendly, to flirt, to go on dates, to, like, that's the thing. Like, I feel like what a lot of times we do is we are like, Lord, send me a husband, and then you sit at home in your bed, and then you're like, I hope he comes here.
He's never going to make he's never going to make a move.
Out in the world.
He's never going to do anything. Ladies, he's never doing anything unless you give him at least something.
Yes.
Some kind of indication that it's welcomed.
Yeah.
He needs help. He's stupid. Shy and worried, and if he's just a little bad of the eyes, he's like, all right, we're in.
It's okay to go on dates, to flirt, I think we get so scared in the Christian culture of like, oh, like, what if I, you know, look like, it's like, it's okay to have interest in people. Yeah. That's going to happen.
I have a question about leading people on. Like, at what point am I no longer, like, putting myself out there and I'm actually abusing my relationship with someone for self-gratifying?
Well, yeah, that's the issue, right? Is if you're doing it so that you just feel better, so because you feel, you know, I don't feel good about myself, so when I go around that particular person who I'm not interested at all, but they show me attention, I feel better about myself. Just be self-aware of that kind of thing and realize what you're doing to that person sometimes, right? And it's a temptation for everybody. I know that. Yeah.
I think, again, the goal is community, right? And so, like, that's what I talked about. Even in the garden, like, it's not good for man to be alone. If you're doing something that's divisive to the community, that would divide brothers and sisters, that would divide people, you don't need to be doing that. Same if, okay, like, let's say you go on a date with someone, doesn't work out, you don't need to be gossiping to everyone about it. We need to be building the unity of the community. Oh, that rhymed, sorry. Didn't mean to. But that's the thing, as you're going on, because this is going to happen in young adults, this is what's going to happen. But we need to be encouraging and loving and kind to one another because this is naturally going to happen within this group. So.
And I would also like give advice just to go to trusted friends, not the whole young adults of like who you dated or who you went on a date with, because it's not good to gossip either. So. Yep.
This is a good question. Do you think that being sanctified, which is, this is our goal, right? Being sanctified and shaped into the image of Christ is easier when you are married or when you are single.
It's going to happen either way.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. God is God.
Yeah. By the way, you know, the whole waiting thing, how many times do we have to wait on the Lord? Yeah. Now, we've had to wait on the Lord as married people, single. You're going to wait on the Lord. I'm sorry. That's just life. So don't think that there's going to be some magic bullet that's going to solve that. You're going to always be waiting on the Lord. Treat this as good training because it's going to happen. You want everything to happen quicker all the time. I wouldn't worry about the sanctification. The Lord's going to sanctify you. Congratulations. He's committed to you. He's committed to you. He's going to chop the edges off. Your job is to remain faithful in the midst of it. And say, Lord, I know that you've got a plan for me. And even though this hurts or this is a challenge at this time, I'm going to get up tomorrow morning and I'm going to try to follow you.
I got a question about being unequally yoked. What does that mean? Jeez. To be unequally yoked? What are the consequences of that? And is this applying to just Christians and non-Christians or different levels of Christians?
No, it's a Christian and non-Christian. And it's probably more applicable in its original context to people who are idol worshiping versus Christian people. Probably more in a business partnership context, just so you know. That doesn't mean it doesn't apply to marriage. I think it does. Absolutely. I'm sorry, that was overly simplistic.
Yeah, I mean, but also, like, what are the consequences of
being unequally yoked?
Yeah.
All right, so I'll tell you something. I'll tell you what I told a girl who was going to marry a guy who wasn't a Christian, and she was absolutely... And so I sat at Subway with her, and I remember... saying, okay, so here's the future for you. I can think of like a few things that will happen. Option one, you're gonna marry this guy. He's gonna come to faith in Jesus and be the greatest father ever. And you know, you guys are gonna be like and you'll have a story to tell. And they'll do the video of you and say, I was, you know, she married me, and then I came to Christ, and I know that's what you want. Like that's your goal. Option two is that you're gonna get married and you're gonna remain faithful to Christ and He will never be interested. And then you're gonna have children and the children are gonna probably take more from their father than their mother because that's just the way it works. And then your heart's gonna break because you have a bunch of children who don't want to follow Jesus, which is gonna be the greatest heartbreak of your life. Option three, you're gonna get married to this guy, and you think that he's gonna come your way, but you're actually go his way. And after a while, you stop attending church because it's a lot better. I mean, guys, it's a lot more fun things to do on a Sunday morning, right? Especially, you know, you water ski, or you could go on a hike, or you do a lot of things, right? So you're gonna start thinking, and he's always after that, and the kids are always after that. So you just decide you're just gonna go in that direction, and eventually you will drift away from the faith, and ultimately. This decision right now is actually the key decision to you losing, to you abandoning and shipwrecking your faith. And so there are eternal consequences in that. It's going to demonstrate you never really knew Christ to begin with. Now, I know the first one is the one you want. But I'm telling you that the just simple percentages is that's about a 1% chance. So just pragmatically, what do you want to do? But I love him so much. Uh-huh. The problem is the most important thing in your life, which is Jesus, he does not share. Mm. And so this is a moment for you to decide whether or not you love Jesus or you love something else. Just like the rich ruler, just like, right, Jesus saying, if you don't give up everything you have, you can't be my disciple. This is one of the everythings you want.
I was just going to add to that, too. Biblically, Solomon, who was the wisest man on earth, that was a gift God had given him, was wisdom. God told him not to intermarry or marry women who...
Different gods.
...had different gods. But he did, and it drew his heart away. And that was the warning, was that they will draw your heart away. And that's exactly what you were saying. And
you
yeah,
live long
it,
enough.
It's a warning.
You it live is, long enough, and Jeannie and I have yeah. seen so many.
Yeah. I've seen it over so and over and over.
So many happen over yeah. and over again. Again, like and we, I think there might be one example that I know of where they got married and the guy or the girl came to faith in Christ and happily ever after. But it is like 1%.
So kind of following up from that question that kind of relates, is why then does it seem that the wrong man or the wrong woman that I think could be the one for me to marry but is really leading me astray, why do they keep coming into my life? Why does the wrong person...
Is what's behind that the idea that, like, why is God bringing them along all the time?
I'm asking the question.
Yeah, well, I mean, I can apply that to lots of things. Like, why in the world is that, you know, why is it whenever I open my computer, it's on the internet, and there are all these porn... Lord, why are there so many porn sites that are out there? If you didn't want me to look at it, then that wouldn't be an availability all the time. We could do this about almost everything. Lord, if you don't want me to steal all this money, why is it that I'm always around it all the time at the bank? My point is, your life is going to be filled with temptations. Don't go down that way. Proverbs 5:7. Don't go down that street, young man. The adulteress is down there luring you in. You don't go down that street. Applies to women as well. Opposite. You don't need to go down that street. It'll kill you. I know it looks lovely and fantastic, but the passage in the end says it's like she'll bring you in and choke you out. You're going to die. You're going to be like a bird in a trap, and you'll be devoured.
I think we often think God is being like sneaky with us, of like, oh, he's bringing this guy around, or all this, and it's like, you know, everything we're doing, we need to commit to prayer and be thinking, is this leading me to God or away from God? And so if this guy is around, but he's leading you away from God, that's probably not where God is leading you. And just like, don't try to, you know, try to figure out like, oh, maybe if I can get inside God's head and figure out the next, like we do that with so many things in our life of like, yeah, if God just tells me, you know, what I need to eat for breakfast this morning, then this will happen. It's like, we need to trust that God has the best intentions for us, but we need to also be honest with ourselves when something is not good for us, when something is bad and leading us away from him.
God's not trying to hint to you through signs. You know that, right? That's not, I know that that's the way we Bruce Almighty goes and stuff, but it's not the way that it works. You're not required to read the tea leaves to figure out what God wants you to do. I know what God wants you to do. He wants you to flourish where he's placed you today. And guess what? You'll end up being placed lots of other places. I promise. And then flourish there.
So kind of a theological question. For those who are married, can or would a true disciple of Jesus pursue a divorce?
Yeah. I'm waiting for you guys. I can answer the question, There are some in the New Testament. There are some examples of or places where divorces is permitted. One of them is sexual immorality, or the Greek word porneia, which covers a bucket of sins of a sexual nature. Jesus says that in Matthew 19 and also Matthew 5, that except for porneia, a man who divorces his wife, she remarries, he forces her to commit adultery, or she commits adultery. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 7, he actually addresses a situation where you've got a man who's married, or a person who's married to a believer, an unbeliever married to a believer, and the unbeliever doesn't want to be married to a believer anymore, and they abandon that particular person, that the language is, let them go. You know, you don't need to stand in the way of them getting divorced. If you, according to 1 Corinthians 7, if you get divorced, and it doesn't it's not within the framework of what the scriptures say is permissible, remain unmarried. And there's some debates over some of the other stuff. Like, in our world, abuse becomes a big question. And there's lots of discussion around that. I have a view on that would probably include some of it, but would include abuse as part of a reason why it is that somebody would be permitted to get divorced. But I would say the problem that we have is that we take that word abuse and then we expand it in our culture, right? To everything, right? Like he told me or she told me that we can't afford to buy Taco Bell this week. That's financial abuse. And if you think that's a joke, I have sat in rooms and it's not been Taco Bell, but it's been like some fast food restaurant. And you're like, I don't think that's abuse. It is to me, right? Oh, okay, but there's deeper issues there. But yes, divorce is something that should be avoided as much as it possibly can. But you know what? Healthy marriages are a product of healthy disciples, right? Like that, your job is not to have a healthy marriage. Your job is to be a healthy disciple. And the Lord's placed you in a marriage. And that's the context in which you can be a healthy disciple. So be a healthy disciple in singleness. Be a healthy disciple in marriage. And your marriage will keep going. If your heart's soft to the Lord, your marriage will keep going. I promise.
I know there are more questions coming in, but we do have to stop at some point. And so I have one more. And if we're talking about how all this really is, it's a community thing. That's what this is about. How can we, and now this is not just Harvest Young Adults, for our whole church, how can we all encourage a healthy culture where marriages are healthy, dating relationships are healthy, and singleness is not looked down upon? How do we encourage that kind of a culture?
I think one thing, is it on? Okay, sorry. I think one thing that I would encourage, if you start dating, stop disappearing. Because a lot of young adults, they come here single and they start dating someone in young adults or out of young adults and they just disappear. Or they get married and they just disappeared. That's what makes it harder for other young adults to be single, is because all their friends just like leave and focus on their boyfriend or girlfriend and make them their everything. Like, this is a community, so we should stick together and encourage each other and also just be that example of a godly marriage to other young adults around you, or a godly relationship. Because when you start dating, you're supposed to be in community more than less. It doesn't make sense. You're out of community more when you start dating someone. That's not a healthy relationship, to be honest. That's just my opinion, but I think that's also biblical. Like, if you are dating someone, be in community, and just so people can pray, be around you and pray around, pray for you. And also, if you're both alone most of the time, it's just going to lead to sin. So, yeah.
Yeah, if you're here and you're married or you're in a relationship, you're awesome, and I love that you're here, and I'd love to see more of that. The first young adult small group I was in, well, like 8 or 9 years ago, had I think 3 or 4 couples in it, and so it was about 50-50. Single young adults and married young adults. And one of the coolest things about that, it was a co-ed small group, but one of the coolest things about that was being in community with other guys, talking about like the first year of their marriage or the first several years of their marriage, and kind of like seeing what they were learning and the ways they were being sanctified. And we need more groups that involve both co-ed and also like couples and single people in community together. I think that people really rub off on each other in terms of what they're learning and how they're being sanctified within that stage of life that they're in. So tell your married friends to come hang out with us.
Yeah, dude, I totally agree. Like, when I came into this community, I was not married, and I loved and appreciated my married friends. And now I am married, and I still love and appreciate my single friends. Like it didn't change, like, because I just love the people. And my life, like, I need these people. And so I don't know why I would ever want to remove myself from those people that have proved to be so good for me. I think that's something to remember, like the people in your life have made you who you are, like you need them. It's good for you to have them in your life.
I think first and foremost, we're like the body of Christ is a community. So it's, I think a lot of times we think very individualistically about church and like we are called to one another. Like that is love one another. Like so much of the scripture is about that. And I think a big part of this is have wide circles of people. Like even not just within young adults, like please get to know an older woman, an older man, an older couple. Like there's amazing widows at our church who are just so awesome. And there's so many people that we need to get wisdom from, especially as young adults. Like we need those people in our lives. And so I think it really is not isolating yourself, being in community with a lot of different people and knowing that we should all be teachable. Like no season is better than another. And every season has its hard parts of it as well. And so we want to be able to bear one another's burdens, but also be able to be in community alongside each other. So, yeah.
Jeff or Jeannie, any thoughts?
We're done. Just past our bedtime, dude. You have no idea. Like we're
all right. I got one. I got one more thought. Then, I mean, what I hope for us is that I don't know. I hope that we would be okay and gracious with each other when we make mistakes. You know. For like the person who maybe did isolate themselves a little too much at first because they were excited and had a new relationship and, you know, yeah, they weren't around as much, but, you know, they're like, oh, I realize that, like, I need these people, or like, maybe they don't realize it, but like, we should be gracious with each other. Like, we're all figuring this out and we don't know what we're doing all the time. You know, we're married. We don't know what we're doing all the time. There's some of you who are dating. You don't know what you're doing all the time. A lot of you are single and you don't know what you're doing all the time. Like, that's okay. I think we should really be gracious with one another. And the second thing that I think would help us really avoid a lot of pain in our relationships is to not be selfish. I mean, that's what ruins a marriage, is to be selfish, is what ruins a community, to be selfish. If every time I pursue a person, it's about me and what I can get out of this and what people are going to think when I do that and what people are going to think when I start dating that person. And it's just about me, and I'm not genuinely concerned about the best for this person that I'm pursuing or this person who is my friend, then we're totally missing it. And yeah, I mean, it's not going to be fun to have all these dating relationships and people pursuing one another. Like, but if we know that we care about one another's best, I want God's best for your life. I want to see God allow you to flourish just like you would your spouse, to see God use them and their life to flourish. If we had that attitude towards one another, regardless of what kind of relationship we were in, I think we would be very, very joyful, happy people because we see God working in all these relationships. And then when we fail and we're selfish, to have grace for each other, if we can do that and repent of our selfishness, I mean, I would be thrilled. I think the Lord would be honored and glorified in the way that we treat one another. And so, I mean, that's my hope.